pleasure of having one of our own, this Dr. Igor Efimov. Dr. Efimov received his undergraduate degree and master's degree from the Institute of Physics and Technology in Moscow. And then went to the Institute of Biological Physics in Chisinau, which is not so far from Moscow, where he did his PhD on, I think, spirals in hearts with Valentin Prinsky, that many of you know. He used to spend a lot of time with us both in Case Western Reserve and here. And then Igor came to this country and did a postdoctoral fellowship with Gisa Lama, where he studied and mastered the art of optical mapping of what we're using both of sensitive dyes. And then there was a movement from that University of Pittsburgh to the Prison Clinic, that included several people, including Dr. Edmund. And that's when I grabbed him and pulled him to Case Western Reserve University. So he joined us at Case Western Reserve University, I think a little bit later than Dr. Sui, around the same time. And finally, we all crossed the Mississippi to the west side of it, and we are all here now. So Igor is an associate professor here, but will be full professor coming July 1st. So he also deserves congratulations for his promotion. Igor, will tell us everything we want to know about the Efimov.
So thank you very much, Jerome, and thank you everyone for coming. It's a real honor. I think I'm one of the first presenters at the seminar. It became a great addition of our cardiovascular community at Washington University. I'm the first speaker who speaks a second time maybe in this program. My first presentation was 3 years ago on defibrillation, and now I'm talking about an entirely different subject of the functional anatomy of the AV node. And most of the work I will show today, I'm really glad to report it, most of the from here, from Washington University, and especially half of the presentation will be the most exciting part from here, it is what we accomplished basically today we're here in the first row. This is a collaboration with a clinical with the surgery department on the human nerve junction. So this is my plan for today. So we'll talk about history of the AV node, because history actually is quite exciting. It's over 100 years. Now, I will talk about AV node function in general, especially for students, why AV node is so interesting and important. I'll talk a little bit about arrhythmia, also eventually end up with slides showing that finally we can visualize AV node arrhythmia in the human heart using fluorescence techniques. I'll talk about cellular and ion channel diversity, that is represented in the AV junction, which in my opinion is one of the most complex structures in the heart. And finally, I will talk about the dimensional architecture of the AV junction, which currently becomes a very interesting subject because finally, using not just histological techniques, but also new imaging modalities as well as new molecular mapping modalities, we can finally dissect this very, very complex, very complex structure in the very different compartments. Then I'll allow myself also to go wild and speculate about future technologies and our clinical colleagues will correct me if I'm wrong in my speculations. So what is that of history of AV node? Last fall I was in England, there was a centennial anniversary of the discovery of AV node celebrated by a conference in Manchester, UK, and Mark Boyd, my good friend and colleague for many years, collaborator, shared those slides which I really like and I decided to borrow from him. So these are very interesting slides, and those of you who don't know should borrow it immediately, because if you teach any lectures on cardiology, you have to show those slides. These are two murals created by Diego Rivera in Mexico City. And they're really beautiful, you can see. So the essential history of cardiology on your left, you can see a functional side of cardiology on your right, you can see a structural or anatomical pathology side of cardiology. And for the today's presentation, this particular part is very important, as you can see in this slide. But the right neural, and I'll focus on it in detail. This shows discovery and main contributors to the discovery of the conduction system of the heart. And the thing that's in here, although historically it's not entirely correct, I was not quoted here, but the first discovery was actually done in the AV noodle area. So now Tavara worked in the Ludwig Aschoff's lab in 1906, published a book presenting very clear morphology criteria for the AV node, which is the only electric bridge between AVN and ventricles. And only a year later, Slack and Keith following one of Stavara, actually following his morphology criteria, also discovered tetra node, which for the next century became a very popular structure studied by so many people. That AVN unfortunately became somewhat of a Cinderella in morphology field. And of course, also the important contributions of his leukemia, which in fact was made earlier before the discovery of the AV node. So this is how Sunao Tavara presented his bundle to the AV node, which actually in Russian is called Tavara node. I don't know why this particular atomic structure did not receive recognition by his name or the name of the discoverer. And this is how he put it essentially by him, the whole structure on the left side. And this is how it looks like in those days when he had to inspect numerous histological slides and hand paint. It's a really beautiful book which was recently reproduced, finally translated into English and reproduced one to one from original German publication. So it's located in the what is now known as the angle of Koch, and this is actually a publication of Koch himself, so this is where I would look for it. And this not this location because in my references to the human data I will be following the same anatomical orientation such that essentially the conduction axis will be from inferior to superior, his bundle will be meeting them 90 degrees here. So we also have coronary sinus here, inferior and superior media power. So first of all, the introduction about the overall function of AV node. So AV node, of course, as really textbook physiology teaches us, is a very important structure which introduces interventricular excitation delay, which is very important for proper feeling of ventricles and proper eventually ejection fraction. And if you look carefully at this map, you can see that that bit of course starts from the SA node, spreads over AVN, having both sides like the mechanical CGA, EG is very visible, muscle excitation of the ventricles. In this case, you can see that excitation appears over AVN as well, but in reality, for different region in which AVN is so transparent, there are parts that you can see through the AVN, you can see, in fact, in particular excitation from the AVN. But of course, also AV node is very important by protecting ventricles from atrial arrhythmia, such as atrial fibrillation. So without AV node filtering technique, more than 2 million patients with chronic atrial fibrillation wouldn't be able to sustain life in their ventricles. And finally, AV node becomes the secondary junctional pacemaker in case cathode node fails. Interestingly, in my lab recently showed, 45% of cases when you have atrial fibrillation from the right and you suppress excitation in the SA node by, for example, stimulating locally vagal system, so the pacemaker shifts in 45% of cases to the AV junction. And you saw in this movie that basically shifts goes from SA node to AV node in a very, very rapid fashion when you apply artificial simulation which allows us to suppress variation of acetylcholine as we know in the normal location. So therefore, AV node is a very, very important secondary of substituted pacemaker. So careful studies are done with lighting nicotine and toxicity with biohacker who just graduated from our lab last November, show that in the rabbit, at least, an AV jointly model pacemaker or a junctional pacemaker is located actually not in the AV model itself, but in the posterior model extension. And for how they are known in the human inferior model extension. This is a conduction map with neurosurgical junction on AV. You can see that impulse originates here. Relatively rapidly propagates towards the heat bundle, and then upon substantial delay, breakthrough and excites the atrium. So this excitation is very, very slow here. And we found that in the rabbit, this particular pacemaker was very consistently found in every single rabbit out of more than 100 which we already studied. Bill also investigated that this pacemaker in the heat injunction can be modulated the same way as this animal can be modulated by application of sympathetic and parasympathetic stimulation. So upon application of sympathetic stimulation, you can double the rate of the resumptional pacemaker, which essentially translates to the normal physiological heart rate. So we, based on the data, we speculate that in those cases when SMO does not work, the six-sinus syndrome, for example, it is feasible by stimulating proper branches of the sympathetic nervous system to bump up, ramp up the frequency of the adjustment pacemaker to normal physiological rates and essentially replace normal sinus node with the adjustment pacemaker. But also it gives you very nice range of frequencies by application of vagal stimulation. You can slow down this pacemaker also to a considerable degree. Of course, such very tight control by autonomic nervous system of the adjustment is achieved through the fact that AV node, which is visualized here by a specific marker neurofilament 160, is also very, very heavily innervated. So we found that density of parasympathetic and sympathetic nerve fibers is about 5 to 6-fold higher in the AV nodal tissue as compared to apical or ventricular myocardium. So this stretch is very heavily controlled by autonomic nervous system. So arrhythmia in the AV node, in fact, became somewhat of a main figure of English about arrhythmia. So you already know from the figure Gordon Moore. When someone talks about re-entry and tries to introduce this concept to students or fellows, they always use a figure like that. But in fact, the figure was introduced initially as explanation of AV nodal re-entry. And essentially, this was done by Mendelssohn Moore 40 years ago. You can see that from this figure that functionally, impulse arrest from the atrium, it can reach into the ventricles through two separate functional pathways, alpha and beta. Those two pathways have different conduction delay and they're known to result fast and slow. So the first pathway can conduct fast, the slow can conduct slow. However, in addition to that, they also can be from refractory periods. So if you accelerate the rhythm in the atrium and apply a premature pulse, in this case, one of the pathways, the fast pathway, will block. The flow pathway will continue propagating. So the result is set the stage for re-entry and with this microvessel recording and the system will provide you with some evidence how such re-entry can be set. However, until very recently it was poorly understood what exactly is the anatomic substrate for those functional entities, slow and fast pathway. And if you look in the literature back in the 60s, 70s and 80s and 90s, there was a lot of speculations on exactly those pathways are they actually anatomic in nature, or maybe they're just functional entities. And recently, through work from Don Becker and his group, and this one of the papers showing that in fact there is anatomic structure, which is known now as inferior nodal extension, but actually in this particular diagram is supposed to be posterior nodal extension. There was a substantial degree of controversial domain distraction. The landmarks we were to use, and there was even an international conference on the name of the structure. So now the section name, inferior extension, I believe, is commonly accepted. The bottom line is that AV node here, there's a very long structure which goes quite a substantial anatomic distance, very close to the coronary sinus. And this structure shares the same morphologic criteria as compact AV node tissue. And there is data from rabbits, and also now we have data from humans, which suggests that this structure, in fact, also shares not only rheumatologic criteria, not only physical, but also shares very similar physiological signature, meaning that it's very, very slow, it's in that instruction, which also has very interesting differences-dependent properties, different from what you have. So, on the other hand, through our work of Jacques and his group over many, many years, we also know that in the rabbit satellite in humans, when he plotted a compact knot and then below it a spatial extension and lower nodal bundle structure, essentially that below the compact nodal structure, and he suggested that these two tissues are different, and again, it continues to propagate all the way to coronary sinus. Why this structure is important? Because this is exactly what clinicians target during ablation of the nodal-oriented tachycardia, which is a very important clinical arrhythmia. So, in my previous life at Cleveland, I studied this arrhythmia with Dr. Mazdiev, who taught me everything I know about aortic nodes, using primary private preparation, which has been very, very popular preparation for many, many years. And this is how such preparations look like. So as I know, we are located approximately here. So this is superior vena cava. This is coronary sinus, inferior vena cava. And you can see where we focus. So his bundle electrodes are located here. This is where we would send his electrogram. And AV node will be located approximately here. We will apply with the electrodes and find the signature of very characteristic action potential on the AV node. What is interesting is in this very simple arrival preparation, you can easily induce the end. You apply a premature pulse, propagates very slow, and now you can re-enter through the fast pathway. So essentially what I showed you in the very movie, fast pathway is located approximately here, and slow pathway goes along this very long number, which I showed you as a structure. So this functional signature of the re-entry is very important because, as I said, 90,000 clinical cases are treated every year by ablation in my country alone. And ablation is achieved by basically burning a small region of tissue right here where this bundle is inferior nodal extension, but also where this functional, very slowly propagating signature of the small pathway. When we analyzed a very large number of rabbits, and we found there is a great degree of diversity how exactly those functional and slow and fast pathway are located in the AV junction of the rabbit type. So we found that in 65% of the cases, this slow pathway goes into the AV node, which is located approximately here, and his bundle, but also it's split off into a separate fast pathway before merging into the AV node. So there must be some kind of anatomic or molecular entity behind this bifurcation in the pathway. But in the remaining 35% cases, fast pathway does not separate from the compact AV node. It essentially goes high. The button was not brought from the AV node itself. So recently, as I mentioned already, we were able to do the same kind of work in human. And this is one of the designs. Actually, this paper has been published in circulation. And again, this is an example where we show this triangle of approximately here. This is a ventricular septum, atrial septum on this side. And you can see the scale is 1 centimeter. So this is the area which clinicians would target for ablating the slow pathway. This is where the normal electrogram would be recorded. When you stain this tissue, same way we did staining with rabbit or dog heart, with voltage sensitive dye, we, in this case, we use dye for an extra additional dye used by many, many laboratories and commercially available. So you can see a very nice looking action potential recorded from with a very large number of people inside. I will focus only on this part of the field of view. So you can see here there are two sets of recordings overlapped, one on top of another. So one is red, another one is blue. So the blue one corresponds to conduction through the fast pathway. So the fast pathway, which I explained earlier, this is a pathway which allows much more rapid conduction from entering to his bundle. But at the same time, this pathway has a longer recovery period, and when you apply a premature impulse, it will block. And then the impulse has nowhere else to go but through the small path. So if you look at any of these boxes, you can see that there are very sharp recording of his bundle in the blue, and blue action potential carries constant conduction through the fast pathway. And then when I apply premature impulse, and I record from the same side, you can see a very small jump over here, which is his recording. The slow pathway, and you can also see very different optical equations. So optical equations are different quite dramatically, as well as electrographs. So using those equations, we can reconstruct how exactly impulse propagated when it's conducted through slow pathway and fast pathway. So what we essentially do, in every single, you can see, of course, one of those in the beginning. And you can see that for both loop and real signal, they correspond to each other. They coincide because it corresponds to the excitation of atrial tissue on the top of the atrium. So an atrial tissue would be excited the same way no matter which way you go, for the small or fast one. This is why they are identical pretty much. But what the difference is, if you can consider the excitation of the second component. So here, for example, you can see it in the blue signal, it will be very over here. It's much, much smaller. And it will be very in time. So identifying both components, I can build maps like that. So in great scale, I show map on this particular box. So you see the AU node here, the continuous extension here bundle above. So when I apply stimulation at this point, you can see very rapid excitation, a long fiber orientation to 60 centimeters per second, and a slower perpendicular fiber orientation at 30 centimeters per second. But still, this particular excitation takes very short period of time. You can clearly see less than 30 milliseconds, the whole field of view will be excited because it goes through atrial tissue. And atrial tissue has sodium channels, has low impedance gap junctions, and therefore the condition is very rapid. And then, upon some delay, you can start seeing the second component here. The fast pathway is engaged, it goes into the heat bundle, but also goes in very greatly in the slow pathway. At the same time, you can see a very large piece of electric ground. Now I apply premature impulse. So this is impulse which could come, for example, from premature atrial contraction. So the fast pathway now blocks because it has a longer refractory period. So the impulse can no longer excite through the fast pathway and has to go through the slow pathway. And you can clearly see how it goes now. So it's taken from the essentially inferior to superior direction. And I will compare those two maps. So you can see again, fast pathway goes like this, directly almost into his bundle. While slow pathway has to go from here to the So this is exactly what one would expect if method would be done with catheters. But in this case, optical technique allows us to make very, very precisely and very rapidly within essentially two single heartbeats, one for slow and one for fast pathway. So when we look also at histology, we identify those structures as functional and how, because it's explanted hearts, it's not hearts. Patients. These are hearts explanted from recipients of donor hearts. You can see, if I go back for a second, so it is a section for epithelial extension, AV node, and his bundle. And these are exactly the location of those sections. Epithelial extension is a small bundle which is targeted for ablation. This is compact AV node. And this is his bundle. This is exactly where the electrode was located for recording his electrogram. What we also found interestingly, from a clinical standpoint, and we found that if you look at amplitudes of his bundle electrogram, you put it from the same location by the same electrode. In one case, when the excitation goes to the fast pathway, another to the slow pathway, you can see a very large difference in amplitudes. So in this case, the fast pathway is 1.2 millivolts, while in this case, an order of magnitude is less. So we don't know the explanation yet, but we now speculate that perhaps his bundle, which usually is considered just a uniform uniform bundle connecting essentially every individual. In fact, they have two domains which have very different properties. So when you refer to the fast pathway, it may affect much larger domain, much larger amount of tissue. This creates much stronger electrode, which is compared to the slow pathways. What's interesting is this preparation we were able to induce single reentrant beads. So this is one now we two from this electrode, you can see excitation. And then upon delay from this area, from the fast pathway, you can see the AMP right there. So this is the first visualization of AMP in the human heart, obtained with voltage-sensitive dyes. However, I have to admit that this particular study had a very important limitation. We used traditional voltage-sensitive dye foreigners, which unfortunately has a very strong limitation in terms of depth of separation. So as I mentioned, most of those structures can lie at very large depth inside of the tissue below radial myocardium and connective tissue. because water sensitive black dye for our nest does not penetrate probably below 500 to 1 millimeter, we cannot see very much. And as a result, we miss a substantial part of the entry surface, for example, here. So you see this big dark line shows part of the surface which we could not visualize. And I will show you at the end of this talk application of new novel water sensitive dye just developed by a lab from the medical school, which allows us much longer wavelength time, which allows us to penetrate much deeper and see essentially the entire entry surface. Let me spend some time talking about work on cellular diversity. So, in morphology, it's more that if you make a section for the AV junction, you can see that at least three different cell layers. So, first you have atrial myocardium, which is very tight to pack the myocardium. Then below the transitional myocardium, loosely packed cells, which are elongated. And finally, you have a form of the very small cells, which forms a basket-like structure located here. A number of years ago, John Gibb published a beautiful paper. He did it all by himself, just one person without any assistance. He impaled a bit about more than 900 microelectrodes in many, many red cards. He presented a very large map, a functional map of the junction in the red card. And he found there are six different cell types. So this is what one called N-cell or normal nodal cell. So it's characterized by slow rise, lack of the spike in dome morphology, and also a lack of columnar response. So you can see that incremental essentially amplitude. So when you apply impulses bunched together in time, response will be with a small amplitude. When you allow for recovery, there will be a very large amplitude. So clearly it indicates that these cells don't have sodium channels, they're probably primarily calcium channel dependent in their conduction. But also they have very, very slow conduction velocity. The N cell has essentially transitional morphology between atrial and nodal. And you can see that there is a very sharp upstroke, there is spike and dome morphology. There is more profound kind of behavior, suggesting again full threshold excitation kind of behavior. We also identified several other types of cells. So NH cell is transitional cell between node and heat bundle. And again, one might come up with a number of hypotheses, which ion channels have to be present here and which ion channels have to be absent. There's another interesting cell, which we call ANCO, which has a very sharp spike in dome morphology, although here you don't see spike very well. But basically suggesting that these cells probably have very high density of IGO. And finally, there are a couple more types also. This is heat bundle cell, again, very nice upstroke, very long plateau phase. This is already a cell which really could identify your sodium channels. But also, another transitional cell is the low nodal bundle, which again has a slightly more morphology here. So, in summary, Jacques, in this paper published over 20 years ago, basically summarized six types of cells. He put them on the map. Unfortunately, his mapping was done only in two dimensions, so he could not control the depth of impairment of microelectrodes, so he could not really tell why in this particular area he has presence of all six types, but because he could not resolve the depth. And up to now, it's not done yet. We don't know yet at what depth these cells are found. But what is interesting, any cell physiologist can immediately come up with a number of hypotheses, which particular ion channels could be present in each of those particular cell types. And clearly, it suggests a dramatic degree of diversity of ion channels in the AV junction, probably unparalleled by any other structure, except maybe for SMR. And these are characteristics also of action potentials. So essentially, hypotheses can be drawn on the recurrence of action potentials, but unfortunately, they are still hypotheses. We don't have much data on that. I just want to present data from Arina Dabinsky, our collaborator. She analyzed in detail mRNA distribution in AV nodes versus atrial and ventricular structures. Also, I would like to present the speculation why do we believe there is such a great difference. So, if you look at transcriptional regulation of during heart development, you know the different heart fields are controlled by different transcription factors. And in particular interest, T-box family of the transcription factors. Essentially, recent work from Anton Bruno's group suggested that in the mature heart, different chambers of the heart are controlled by different transcription factors. And if you look at the different family of fine tumor cells in their function. They seem to be fairly controlled by a particular isoforms of T-box2 and T-box3 for the primitive myocardium, which in part, for example, AV node, SI node are part of the primitive myocardium. While T-box5 appears to control mature working myocardium. And this group actually already presented several papers in which they control expression of T-box isoforms and alter expression of different ion channels and connected isoforms. Very elegant work. What we basically speculate based on this work that in the AV junction alone, because the AV junction forms one of the last structures during morphogenesis by fusion of atrial and ventricular septa, this fusion of different tissues of different origins provides essentially a microcosm of different cardiac fields controlled by different transcription factors. This is perhaps why there are bundles within only 550 to 100 microns from each other, which have completely different substrate for epiphysiology. They express completely different ion channel isoforms, and I'll show you some data on that, and completely different connection isoforms. So, Tony Mandel presented some time ago this diagram showing what kind of ion channels can be present in the area, but again, if you refer to the AV node, we have to be very specific where exactly we are. Because as I showed you, based on the action potential morphology, compact node could be completely different from structure just 50 microns above in the radial myocardium. And of course, completely different from the sheath bundle. So, especially considering that we know now, even though there are still ion channels in the heart, one can actually show that many of these channels are present within just a few cubic millimeters of the junction. Of course, now potassium channels is another very interesting family which also is present in a great degree of diversity in the AV junction. So, Karina Dabrinsky, Mark Boyd, and their group conducted a very large scale study in which they analyzed mRNA in both SA node and AV node in the human heart. Basically looked at this gene array, and I'll show the data for the AV node. And I'll just go very quickly through, just emphasizing how big the difference in densities with all the limitations, of course, prevalent for this particular approach, analyzing mRNA. But you can see that, for example, there are four different tissues which have been analyzed in this study. Blue is compact AV node, his bundle is in yellow, vagal muscle is in light blue, and ventricular muscle is in black. So if you look at alpha subunits of the sodium channel, you can see very high density in the ventricles and much, much lower density in the compact AV node. And even that, I would probably speculate, it was to some extent contaminated because it was very hard to extract just the compact node and probably some transitional cells that were put into the sample. So you can also see that the great degree of variability in the data. So calcium channels. Interestingly, we now know that there are two main pore-forming subunits, isoforms of pore-forming subunits, CAV1.3 and CAV1.2. And interestingly, CAV1.3 is highly present in the compact AV node and completely absent in all other compartments of the human heart. CAV1.2, principal isoform in the ventricular, and it's a very important one in the atrial myocardium, actually is also found to be present here, but again, I might speculate that perhaps it's to some extent could be a contamination from nearby structures. There's a great deal of diversity in the calcium handler. So here you can see also some very large gradients in ionic receptor and exchangers. Potassium channels also you can find very interesting difference here in Kirk and in the beta subunits. Of course, very important difference in the pacemaker channels. So you can see that HTN4, the principal isoform of pacemaker channels in the human heart, has a very large, very high density. Compact AV node, of course, was also found that very high density of data which I did not show in this presentation. And also, very interesting story about connections. So, we all know that connections, there are four isoforms known to us at this point expressed in the heart. They have a very large diversity. Of course, we know that connection 43 is the primary principal isoform in the ventricles. Also, connection 45 is also present. But it's almost absent in the compact AV node. Contrary to that, if we see a very large presence of MF40 in the avian or virtually absent in the ventricle, of course, presence also in the atrium. MF45 also is present, of course, in the avian. Interestingly, the brain skin for group could not confirm earlier findings for this MF31.9. So they could often come as well as groups. And I believe they also use the same antibodies as the other group. So they basically have some disagreement on the results. So, earlier work by Nick Sears and other groups using immunohistochemistry already showed that the same section from the compact AV node, which of course also includes a set of amoeba and ventricles, you can see this very striking gradient expression. And also you can see the green color here. So, this is AV node. You can see only green color present here. So, only connecting 45. But if you look at the data of section, the ventricular section, have very high density of red color showing expression of connection 43. So very striking difference. The only limitation of studies like that are that they don't have any functional data. So they're essentially achieved by sectioning the heart and identifying only morphologic criteria and then staying sister sections and actually trying to draw conclusions from that. Our approach includes functional data, and I would like to present today to you some interesting findings that we speculated in fact. AV node itself may have carbon micro domains, which one of them is expressing connection 43, another one does not express connection 43. So, essentially, going back to definitions of morphology, there is a great deal of literature on morphology of AV junction because it's such an important, clinically important structure with various arrhythmias present in it. And essentially, the structure can be identified with a compact node with inferior low extension. This is the particular and atrial sector that's formed the science. And as I already mentioned, this structure right here is targeted for ablation during AVNRT treatment, AV node arrhythmia tachycardia therapy. Was not a pathology, so he conducted only functional studies, but basically arrived at the same conclusion from functional from data from analyzing morphology electrograms from microelectrodes or macroelectrodes. The mutation is different in the rabbit from a human just because we are upright animals and rabbits are not. My teacher, Claudio Malgaris, had a much more elaborate picture shown in these diagrams. This is for rabbits and this is for AV and for human. But when this paper was published, this paper still did not know about material extensions and actually this picture needs already revision. It's very different from normal. So 2 years ago, we had a very talented undergraduate student, Megan McKay, who started this particular study and built up it completely. So this was done on human hearts, which we have seen frozen already. We did not conduct functional studies yet on this set of hearts. And what we did essentially was exactly like we did in rabbit previously. So we excised, let's say, parts of the heart, including the triangle of Koch, and bacterial section in each section. In some samples, we have up to 300 of them. Different structures will be identified in superatrial septum, ventricular septum, AV node, central fibrous volume fat. Each tissue then will be processed and we will reconstruct a three-dimensional structure. So what you see here is a his bundle shown in green. This is the AV node. And we found that in the AV node, we will have two microdomains. And I'll show you in a second how we identify the So if you stain for connecting 43 and compare it to histology, you will find that in his bundle there is a region which has connecting 43 and a region which does not. Although in his bundle we were not as sure as in the structure of the compact node as well as extensions. So let's move from his bundle down to the AV node. And again, this is AV node identified histologically. This is the same structure from the neighboring slide, taken only 15 micron apart. You can see that there is a very large compact node structure which does not have any green color present, which means it does not have connection 43. And below it, there is a structure which has very high density of connection 43. This is what we would identify as lower number bundle, as it was known from previous studies. And it's consistently found in all cars we studied in every section which goes to the compact AV node. So essentially, human AV node really has two compartments. One compartment which is larger in size, less connection 43, the other compartment, which is small exercise located below this essentially expression very high density of connections. So if we keep going to the extensions, we found that every factor we looked at least two extensions, which is consistent with finding Anton Baker and his group. But what was interesting is one extension we call it lower left extension and right extension. So left extension would let completely connecting body free, while the right extension clearly has a higher degree of expression of connecting body free. When we put it all together, and now I will show you the four different human parts. So these are from normal males died in car accident, but they're perfectly normal hearts. And these females died of a stroke, but again, hearts are perfectly normal. These hearts were not used for transplantation for non-cardiac reasons. And this particular patient is a 43-year-old pediatric related cardiomyopathy patient who received a transplanted heart. But what you can see in every single heart, and we analyzed already since publication was made in many more hearts, every heart, of course, has a kiss bundle, although they could be very different from morphology, but also has two extensions from the compartmental node, one of which lacks connecting positively shown in light blue, and another one has expression of connecting positively shown in yellow. They can be very different in extension and most of the thickness. For example, this one is very, very small compared to this particular one. But in every human heart, we look at clearly two microdomains. Unfortunately, at this point, we don't have any data specifically about ion channels as well as about other connection isoforms. But now, essentially, we speculate, we hypothesize, and this will be our next presentation for 3 years. Basically, we speculate that these two structures perhaps are controlled by different transcription factors, which come from different developmental fields. And as such, they will have to express different ion channels and different connection isoforms. And we do have some functional data which suggests that this might be true based on assessment of conduction velocity. Suggested statistics again showing the compact mode and the left extension, left connecting 43, because normalized density of connecting 43 normalized to density in the atrium, while kiss bundle, lower bundle, and right extensions do have very high density of connecting 43, no different statistically from atrium. And this is how 3D structure looks like in 3D reconstruction. So this is a belt which I will remove now on both. This is in detail shown in red. Blue is connective tissue. I will remove it. Now you see this bundle here. This is connecting 43 positive extension. Yellow is connecting 43 negative extension. And you also saw a couple of arteries and veins going through this region. So this is normal heart, and this is disease heart from the individual acute device patient. But you can see clearly every part has the same characteristic structure. So what are the clinical implications from what I just said? Again, I'm not a clinician. I can speculate wildly. Stop me if I'm too wild. So we know that this is a very important cardiac structure. And we know it because these are all the clinical impact on abnormalities and pathologies of AV0. So atrioventricular block occurs and 50,000 patients, which of course is treated only by implantation of the pacemaker. AV nodal reentrant tachycardia is treated by ablation in 90,000 patients every year. And then AV nodal ablation is done now routinely to control the excitation of ventricles in patients with chronic atrial fibrillation, which is another 20,000 cases. So it's a very, very large impact in society every year. Almost 200,000 patients are affected by abnormal AV ventricular function. So what we studied in our lab in terms of technology for a number of years in various animal models, I believe now it's becoming closer and closer to realization in the clinical setting. So first of all, functional imaging. So the new dye, and I will show you data in a second, which was synthesized by Leslie Lowell, which had a much longer wavelength of radiation and emission. So emission is achieved above 800 nanometers, and can be probably extended in future generations of those dyes even beyond that. So this new dye which we use has a much larger fractional tension torus, which allows us to record much, much better signals from this body. But most important is a deeper penetration. So which means it also can be done because of the long prevalence in blood, if used in presence of blood. So essentially this dye can be used to be clinically, and now we're essentially trying to to study that bremsicinic possible side effects. And we see so far in all experiments we've done, which is about 8 experiments at this point, we have not seen any impact on actual protection morphology and blood levels. So we believe the technology now is ready for clinical applications. So next story is about structural imaging. So we need to know in correlation not only where it was propagated, but how deep is the structure below and the cardiac surface. Existing imaging modalities such as ultrasound or MRI, unfortunately, do not allow for proper resolution to visualize for the selection of structures. So optical coherence tomography is a very interesting technology, and I'll show you several images which clearly show that it can be done with optical coherence tomography. And finally, of course, we need to look at molecular signatures. Although clinically, I don't know how to use a junction at this point, because it requires biopsy. So essentially what we propose as a future of electrophysiology according to the junction is application of optical mapping, for example, for AVNRT treatment with novel voltage sensitive dye, optical histology or virtual histology with optical coherence tomography. And this technology is already used clinically for coronography and also in ophthalmology field. We also found and arrived that we can bypass AV nodes by stimulating one of those bundles near coronary sinus. So essentially bypassing completely connecting for the negative domain to restoring AV conduction. In humans, it still remains to be shown that in rabbits is clearly an established phenomenon. I already mentioned that AV junction can be used as a pacemaker if we stimulate proper branch of sympathetic nervous system and upregulate the frequency of the AV junction pacemaker. And finally, we also are working on compliant tissue engineering approaches to restore AV conduction by strategic placement of cell material to restore rich conduction between traditional electrical cells and AV nodes. And this might actually be much simpler than the thing if we do have knowledge, specific knowledge, atomic and functional, where exactly AV nodes are located with respect to AV tissue, if there is a gap in conduction between the two. So this is an example from the rabbit card. You can see his bundle and AV node obtained without conducting any histology, just by optical coherence tomography. This is really impressive, so you can achieve it in intact tissue. This is our first data. We've seen them already obtained just recently, and this was accepted for heart treatment presented in May. So this is human heart, which was first imaged optically with new dye. You can clearly see this complex morphology of signals allowing us to reconstruct maps of conduction, two layers of conduction, which I showed you before. And then application of optical coherence tomography clearly showing AV node in his bundle. So you can see here his bundle extension along with his bundle X. And this is just for comparison to histology. You can clearly see this is how his bundle is about deep. And more recently, Vadim further conducted a series of experiments from several times so far, and been able to recapitulate essentially all very interesting phenomena in AV junction we've done before, but now because of use of this new dye, this is named DIAMD, DQBS, I don't like the name, but this is what it is. And he was able to show that application, especially if you remove SA node, you obtain junction rhythm, of course, in control, it's about 30 to 2 minutes. And if you apply isoproparanol, you can accelerate it to about 7 to 2 minutes, which is normal. An application of the cibacolin, of course, will slow it down to 21 bits per minute. And also what we found, unlike in the rabbit, normal pacemaker is located, in fact, in an H region, in the rabbit it was located in an extension. But application of the cibacolin is shifted to coronary sinus, so this whole structure becomes very interesting interaction between two pacemakers. And this is the data. So this is normal junctional lead, you can see originated here, propagated through this slow pathway towards the coronary sinus. You can clearly visualize the whole bundle, which now can be ablated, for example, for ignored reaction technicality. It's not that time. It's called structure visualized functionally. So if you apply isoproterenol, 1 micromolar, you can induce AVNRT. So you saw it originated here, then breakthrough, last pathway, now it will return. Which gives it, and now again works with the plasma. So essentially, this is a loop of AVNRT. this is what you would target, linear calibration. Clearly, the whole circuit is visualized by the four voltage sensitive diode. So we can come up with a technology which allows us to inject this voltage sensitive diode into the proper branch of the coronary artery in the junction. So then it can be very beautifully visualized in the clinical EP lab, and you can very specific about ablating the energy. And finally, application of ACH shows wave distance story. So you can see a couple of these ways related in the same image region, propagated that way. Another one again, we'll start now. That's what we're doing, and that's doing additional cells. But next bit, actually, so this patch will block, will stop producing impulses. And now you will see impulses originating here near the coronary side, clearly showing that two pacemaker locations interacting with each other. So, and let me essentially finish with that saying that this is just the beginning of a very interesting project. I'm really grateful to our clinical collaborators who made it possible. And Dr. Mazami, who was so helpful and generous with us, and his team, Andrew Rollins, who provided us with his optical coherence tomography, Harita Novinsky, Mark Boyer, who shared with us the molecular data, Dr. Schuster, who shared with us pretty much everything we know about large animal models. And I'm also, I'd like to acknowledge contribution from members of the lab. So many years ago, Vladimir Nikolsky worked with me in the office with me throwing to start rapid work on CAV mode. So Vadim is now working on the human preparation that initially was started by Bill. And Bill, despite being a deep PhD student and deep part of the training, still comes back to lab after nice results and working with us without being paid. Megan studied our histology, and now she's a Harvard graduate student, and Crystal helped us enormously, and also now she's in the same lab in Harvard as a postdoc. And Alexei, Kelly, Christina, recently joined the lab and continued this great project. Thank you. So, any questions? Yes.
Unfortunately, we have not seen the fiber, so you have to apply for all the physical tissue, and you have to do some creative tissue clearing as well as actually bringing up the contrast. And there are techniques to do that by chemical techniques. It's a lot of contrast. We had a beautiful presentation by Dr. Boja from Lithuania, who does it really nicely. You can essentially clean the whole arm and you can clear the whole tissue except for nerve fibers. You can build beautiful trees of nerve fibers. It's on our agenda, but at this point we have not done yet. And from a later point of view, of course, you are totally right. In fact, propagation of fibers, the way junction goes along those structures, and you are able to essentially denervate a substantial amount of the AV nerve and his bond, but this is something of consideration which is very, very important. And this is why we essentially trying to develop an alternative. But instead of ablating the electrode pair, which can be, you can interrupt the entry by a single impulse applied using the second injection of the entry. Any more questions?
I think in the older studies, you would see what is thought to be electrophonic conduction, which is going to be a sort of silent portion. But I think in all the electrograms I see, they seem to be continuous upstroke.
Well, essentially, in many cases, we do see what they call the hypertonic conductions. So what I visualized in past movies, it was essentially amplitude of the flow of fluorescence. So this very extremely slow conduction may appear as essentially jump over in the side of the air. So I'm not fully convinced that there's actually true conduction. So we still have to resolve it. So we don't have an answer to that. So but you are right. So in the past, there was actually two hypotheses of the delay. One was Rosenbrook hypothesis, which essentially jump over any segment of the gap, such as super of the gap. And another one would be decremental conduction, which would be consistent with calcium dependent conduction.
And it seems that we have evidence of both. I would speculate that probably there's a jump over inside of the gap for electrotonic conduction. Occurs between additional cells from the A gap can be pumped up more. Well, the calcium dependent slow conduction occurs over the long extension between the extension. Which again will be consistent with finding that this extension probably does not have sodium channels. It's one of them. And it's primarily calcium.
If the, you're talking about the optical action potential and the optical techniques for making the measurements of the monsters, what the technique is and how it works.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't cover this introductory side. So essentially what it is, voltage sensitive dye, the molecule which has a dipole on one end, and this is a sensor of electrical field, and the epithelial layer on another end. So when you deliver it to the tissue through coronary perfusion, so the epithelial tail, of course, will bind to the outer leaflet of the membrane. And the dipole will be pointing out outside. And then when the membrane depolarizes or repolarizes, so voltage changes on the membrane. So dipole will rearrange. And this will translate into changes in spectral characteristics. So if you excite fluorescent molecule and then collect fluorescence, so both absorption and emission spectra will shift a little bit. And this is what we are detecting. We are looking at the emission spectrum, which shifts only by a couple of nanometers, but it's enough for us to detect the difference. Because we are essentially integrating over a very long part of the spectrum, from, let's say, 600 to 700 nanometers. So, well, I think you saw the information for the 20 years. Any more questions?
Other questions? Do you know anything about the difference in length of years?
Yeah, it was something we really want to do. In addition to that, even more, this appears to be a gradient of new density of receptors from superior to inferior in a car along with the receptor signal. But it's not yet proven. It seems that they even not less innovative than ATM. But again, at this point, we just look at our specific hypothesis and the aging ground, which is supposed to be. The problem is essentially that Bill Hacker, who extremely productive, very hard working person, he spent a whole year to polish just one particular training procedure and chat into the transfer training in the rabbit and then in the human. But this is exactly what we want to do.
And the other question, of course, is slow induction in order to detect the various uncoupling of cells and their density of vectors. Anything known about the density of vectors is the slow pathway versus the fast pathway?
Well, the problem is what we propose as a theory for slow and fast pathway is still not fully acceptable, as you might imagine. And basically, they still. What is clear is that density of connections in the compact mode as well as the extension Schlitz connection appears to be much lower compared to the point of my health. So this theory can come clearly what's there. We are not sure yet about the other partner, the connection to the three bodies, although it does seem also to have much lower density if you calculate with respect to the number of cells compared to what's there. The density of cells is much lower, and well, there is a lot of branching. And Jan Pacher and others will show that branching is less complicated in the small condition.
Okay, so no other questions, and thank you.